Here is your room, and if there is anything you want, you need only ask me. Here is a basin, and here is the WC. There is the refectory, and an icon of Our Lady to guard you.
I stayed a week in dear Mucullis. Every morning the White Queen tapped on my door and reminded me of breakfast. I ate in the guests' hall, usually alone, but sometimes the monks would take their meals with visiting relations. I grew used to raw broad beans and to watching the monks eat. They assembled their dishes of food around them like generals marshalling regiments, and were always shouting for reinforcements. Noodles and egg pies, markouk and the lebni yogurt vanished into their beards, and canteens of soup were absorbed with a noise like draining bathwater. This destruction occupied no time at all, but when the little coffee cups arrived, the monks grew dilatory, sniffing and sipping, and leant back in their chairs becalmed. The peace of dear Mucullis was intermittently broken, nuns singing down the passages or the kitchen servants smashing something, but it was peace all the same. The deer partook of that blended strength and meekness which is special to some monasteries, assuring for the white stillness of its rooms, its iron doors and stone-flagged passages, vaulted burrows where monks moved without talking, walls strong and quiet, as their faith. Its stairs were banked with exotic plants in painted pots. There was a printing press, a library, and a musky manuscript room, which Father Gregoire said contained two incunabula and a history of St. Francis of Assisi, written by one of his disciples soon after his death. And in the courtyard lay the marble capitals of Byzantine columns, delicate and luminous, brought from Sidon to be built into the monastery. The chapel dated from the deer's foundation, and was sober and spacious, but poorly constructed. 11 years before, the earthquake had shaken the plaster from its walls in cloudy heaps, and it still lay there,